Welcome to CNN Precision Spindle. I'm Bill Murphy. So we're going to talk about Bridgeports and Bridgeport 5-packs specifically. The difference between them is, of course, two more bearings in the front. We get them in all shapes and sizes as they come in, including bare shafts with just some of the parts there. These are the tall spacer in the center. We're going to throw these away. The only guys that buy the 3-pack bearings from me are the dealers that want to get a Bridgeport running and sell it. I recommend the 5-pack on everything because more balls equals stiffer shafts. You get better cutting and you're not going to be breaking tool bits as often. This is a typical Bridgeport that's come in. He's been shipped in pieces. He's got his nose cap on there and he's been highly modified, I would say. So this little set screw hole on the top up here, you might want to make sure that you get that out of there before you turn anything, or you end up doing this kind of thing where you're beating it off there, you can't get it out. It's got multiple grabs and scores where the set screw is rubbed. You got to get that out of there. When you take it out there and you see threads, go ahead and drill it, or you leave these little marks that are mashed over threads, and that's what tears up in the housing. Doesn't hurt the quill housing as much as it does the nut. So, these are gonna go away. These center spacers, they don't fit as well on the shaft as you would think. They jingle around too much, and when you tighten up that last nut, you want them to be fairly tight, so this isn't an out of balance condition when you're running. It's a little thing, but it's really important. For this demonstration, we're going to take the Bridgeport apart using jouncing. I've got a UHMW pad here, and I'm going to do that. So up on top here, we've got a nut. Usually doesn't take much to get them out unless they're really in there tight. Okay. Now, this is AN06 nut. This one has a lot more castellations to it, so you know it's a better precision nut. The other ones have four. We just want to loosen that up. Spin that off. Now, a lot of the lock washers you'll get, there will be this little flat one with the tab stuck into the nut, and there's a tapered for the side that goes down. You can buy them pre-bent. This is just from Willett Higgins. It's a pretty good little unit. And then there's flat ones. Now the flat ones, when I use them, I'll actually bend all those tabs back. I have a special little tool for doing that. It's nothing we gotta look at right now. Getting the rest of these off. Again, you could put this in arbor press and press it off. Hydraulic press. Or again, you can just jounce it off. This is gonna go away and get a new one. This one's gonna get ground top and bottom, and I wanna see 1/10 flat and parallel on this unit. These guys are gonna come off. They got angular contacts. They're back to back. Some of these will shear off on the first hit. Some take multiples. That's gonna come apart. We're gonna toss these. This little dirt shield up here, you're wanting to grind that flat and parallel. And then this little piece of bearing, we can warm that up and take him off. Now these pieces are going to get ground, flat and parallel, cleaned up. They should have a little groove in here like this, standing up. This dirt washer goes in here. Dirt shield, debris shield, whatever you want to call it. Make sure it's flat and parallel within 1/10. What we're going to replace that with is what I call a Browning 5-pack. And it's just nothing more than four bearings down here, one bearing up here. Thus the term 5. Browning, because Raleigh E. Browning is the one I learned it from. So you notice the nose cap on that's one of the quick change. This is a Bridgeport. You know it's a Bridgeport because it's got that 45 down here. It does have the collet screw in there. Personally, as a machinist, I hate that little collet screw. I want my collets to go up there grabbing the taper and a little bit more accurate. I don't want them repeating in the same place all the time. So personally, I take that out for my own mill, but you can have whatever you want in there and I can set it up for you. This taper is also something that we take great time to measure. We'll do another video on grinding the taper in here, but we want to see at 3 inches out here, we want to see 2/10 or less run out. That way, when you're milling with it, you're going to be able to hit a thou all day long. And you know how everybody's always measuring their end mills for size? It isn't the end mill that's doing that. It's the taper in your mill. So get your taper cleaned up, get new bearings in it, you'll be a happy camper. So you saw the 3-pack, you saw how good it is, it's got to come apart and go away. The 5-pack seals top and bottom, still got the dirt shield in there. That little piece goes on first down there. It's still in there, still underneath the cap. This one's captured. Here's one that's been in multiple times. You can see the set screw holes. So when you put those guys in, if you're seeing threads, just take a transfer punch. Now I know it's easy, I got it out on the bench and you could be in your machine. Stick this through the housing, a nice tight fit, give it a spot, go in there and drill very gently so you don't ruin the outside threads. But very gently drill until you see chips. Once you see chips, vacuum it out, look in there and you see a diameter at the bottom. Then you know your set screw is going to go down, locate in that spot, and then deburr it. If you don't deburr it, you end up doing this. This one, they've backed off the screw a little bit and then tried to turn it and it tore up the threads and is going to have to be replaced. Again, deburr it with some small hand tool. Don't have to get crazy with it. With these matched, you'll find a match mark, or you should. If you have two pairs that are being matched together, then you're going to have two V's points up and two down. The other one's down. You know what side of the back of an angular contact is because the letters are on the thrust side. Now through the magic of videography, you can't really see this. So we'll get a little bit different example. I know I said little, but it's a big one. So you see the letters on the outside, the make, where it's made, and that is much thicker here than over here. So this one has the marks on the inside, ignore those. This side, the outside race, is where you want to see the letters, that's your thrust side. You're going to take two of those and put them back to back. In this case, the 4, so 2 down and 2 up. That gives you that stiffness. When you get those together and they're matched, if they aren't already coming that way, you want to make that match mark. When matched, I say, they should all have equal load on them when you're trying to do this. These particular ones are tight and you can't move them because it's a fresh one. This one has a shielded rear bearing, or rubber seals, RS. This one was open. The open ones are still great, and you're gonna get a lot of oil in them. That little cup on the side of your Bridgeport, where you oil every day, nobody does. That oil fills up there on the top, and when your quill is clear down, that oil runs over the top, through the bearings, and washes the grease out. So don't overdo that one. You can get just as much oil on your quill housing running it down, putting some oil on it, running it back up. It's going to be plenty. You'll feel the difference. Okay, hope that helps. I'm Bill Murphy. Thanks for watching C&M Precision Spindle.